But we set people up on platforms and we worship them. We want to be like them. We want to talk like them. We want to dress like them. We want to pose like them. I mean, it's a terrible commentary of what's going on in our society. It's all propaganda. It's this big machine, and we're just little tiny cogs paying for it all. I pray that you would help this message to be clear. And we give it over to you, Father. Speak to me so you can speak through me. For we pray this in Jesus' name, begging for, pleading for, and needing the Holy Spirit. Amen. Well, we'll start with Anton LaVey. When asked, it has been nearly 30 years since the Satanic Bible was released. Do you feel its message is as vital today when it was first published? Quote, the message of the Satanic Bible is more pertinent today than when it was written because there are more people who are ready and willing to consider what it states. Why? Because the evangelists of the devil have been at work. Well, you might say, well, I don't listen to ritualistic voodoo music, Christian. I don't even listen to hard rock. I don't listen to heavy metal music. I listen to country and pop and that kind of stuff. Well, the problem is that in most pop and various forms of rock, most have the driving syncopated polyrhythmic elements, the beats, and the satanic philosophy of do what thou wilt. So let's take a listen to Taylor Swift, Rascal Flatts, Miley Cyrus, Britney Spears, and Justin Timberlake. Every single one of these songs feeds the carnal dog. Let's listen. We hope. Waiting for you, but you never come. Is this in my head? I don't know. All the same polyrhythmic voodoo elements driving sensual beats. These are all very popular songs. You want to talk about polyrhythmic? Even the way the keyboard's being. She's polyrhythmically on the level of Michael Jackson. It is all over the place. So we say, do you hear all the same stuff? It's all there. All the ba-ba-boom, ba-boom-boom, boom, ba-ba-boom-boom. It's all there. The polyrhythmic elements are all there. The driving bass, the syncopated beats in the rhythms. It can be the guitars. It can be the keyboards. It can be the drums. It can be little tin cans. It can be anything that's played in all of these different levels. And it takes away that frontal lobe filtering. 1950s. Let's go through a quick little review. Embracing R&B, adding voodoo rhythms, do what thou wilt becomes a secret motto, causing division between youth and parents. On through the 1960s, we start pushing the limits. Christian standards are openly opposed. Sex and drugs use is heavily encouraged. On through to the 70s, Eastern mysticism, occult ideals heavily promoted, anti-government, anti-war, anti-Christ, advocated. The hippie counterculture of free love is in full bloom. Into the 80s, pushing away from absolute truth, Christian boundaries intensely pushed down, dancing flourishes, and lyrics are more overtly sexual. In the 1990s, an open assault on anything moral, uncouth, immoral activities are vividly portrayed. Christians struggle with constant satanic influences. Into the 2000s, a growing interest in occult and Satanism. What was once rebellion and immoral is now acceptable. Sexual and homosexual imagery is everywhere. Now, it is important for you to understand right now, parents, that as we move into the 2000s up to 2011, we are going to be talking about some lyrical content and things that will be of a more sexual nature because that's what's really being pushed out there. We're not going to go really crazy deep and all that kind of stuff, but you might want to consider, if you think it starts getting a little heavy for the tender young ears, you might want to consider maybe not having them in here. I believe if they're over 10 years old, there's not even an issue or a question because they're already hearing this stuff anyway. And that's just the sad reality. Now, in the 1970s, what is amazing to me is this. What was unacceptable in the 70s, for instance, Jim Morrison was not allowed to say the word higher on the Ed Sullivan Show. With his song, Light My Fire, Girl, We Couldn't Get Much Higher, the TV execs were upset and concerned, actually, that if he sang that song, it might lead people to be influenced to get stoned or to get high. And indeed, that's what the song was about, getting high. But they asked him to change the lyric to better. We couldn't get much better. And Morrison said, oh, yeah, okay, whatever. And then he sang the song with the word higher, and the executives lost it. And in fact, he was uninvited and never again. He had 6 more scheduled appearances, and he never was ever able to fulfill those because they said, you're out of here, buddy. So one thing in the 70s, TV still had a moral compass of some sort, and they didn't even want the word higher to be sung. Contrast that with a short 25 years later, in 2000, drugs are actually glorified and promoted. And in Manson carries the torch on this to indoctrinate the masses to use drugs, hate God, and have sex with, well, boys or girls. It doesn't matter. So when you look at this contrast between this here with Jim Morrison talking, and they were afraid of the word higher because it might influence someone to take drugs, versus Marilyn Manson here in his concerts, to where he, and on MTV and all of this stuff, where they could be broadcast, and he has not only talking about drugs, he has an entire song just talking about drugs. He goes, give me a D, or he goes, good D, give me an R, and he spells out drugs. He goes, what's that spell? That spells drugs. And then this 30-foot-wide neon sign that's about 5 or 6 feet tall comes down and just flashes drugs into their minds during the concert. In 25 short years. Things are not getting better. Elvis Presley was censored, waist up, because of his, quote, risque movements. Because he just did this kind of thing. Right? That's the stuff that he was doing. Oh! So they shot him from here up because that little hip thing would start going. Now they're dancing around in almost no clothing, and it's on television. They're rolling around doing inappropriate things on the stage in front of everybody to see. It's almost unbelievable what's acceptable now on television. Most music videos should be censored as pornography. In fact, it's a growing trend for music videos today to be directed by pornography directors. Did you know that? Yes! It's disgusting, but it's the reality. The 21st century so far, I think, could be defined by the scripture found in 1 Corinthians 15:33. Be not deceived. Bad company corrupts good morals. Amen? The Bible is relevant in our day, friends. The emergence, now, this is crazy to me. The emergence of alter egos has become very prevalent in the last 10 years. In the 1990s, dawned Prince and Madonna with their, quote, other selves emerging. Their alter egos. We have Prince and we have Madonna. Prince and Madonna embracing their other selves. Now, Prince's other self, his other alter ego, is Camille. Oprah interviewed him, and during the interview, Prince was unsure as to the sex currently of his alter ego. He didn't know if his alter ego was a male or a female. I just don't get it. I'm sorry. And then Madonna's vile Dita persona, she introduced in her dominatrix book, Sex. That's what the book was entitled, with graphic, inappropriate, pornographic photos in it, and in her different music videos. But what's interesting now is Madonna has obtained yet another alter ego in the 20s, that of Esther, who she refers to herself as to her Kabbalah personality. The media stated that one reason performers will create alter egos is to distance themselves personally from behavior that is aggressively sexual or inappropriate. They blame their bad behavior on them, saying, it's not really me. Well, how convenient is that? What message is this sending to our young people? I can act one way. In other words, I can be the devil and I can be an angel at the same time. Is that true? No, it's not. I can't act like the devil and go, well, that wasn't me. That was just my alter ego. Friends, this is, again, do what thou wilt in just a whole different way now. It's not me doing whatever I want to do. That's just my other ego. Well, how convenient. It's silly. At the MTV Awards, Madonna acknowledged that she uses homosexuality on stage before her impressionable young fans to, quote, desensitize them. They know what they're doing. They have an agenda. But, it's just fun. They're just singing about fun. She knows that homosexual activity, if her followers see this over and over and over again, their convictions will be eroded away. So the MTV Awards in 2003 was disgusting. Madonna comes down, donned as the groom. She's in her black tuxedo-type dress with her top hat. And on one stage, we have Britney Spears. And on the other, we have Christina Aguilera. Both dressed as brides. This is for the whole world, tens of millions of viewers to see. And they all come together. Eventually, they're stripping off lots of their clothing, which they didn't have a lot to start with. And then at the end of this whole song, they actually embrace locked mouth to mouth in a passionate kiss, woman to woman, for the whole world to see. But it's just music. No. And so she turns and kisses one girl and then turns and makes out with the other girl. You see, they were afraid before of the little bit of the antics of Elvis the Pelvis. But now, just a short time later, this happens for millions of viewers to see, and our little kids sit there and watch it. You want to know why homosexuality is going through the roof? Because we're seeing it everywhere. We're listening to I Kissed a Girl and I Liked It. All of these top songs by all these artists that all these little girls are listening to. Here's what Madonna said in The Advocate 1991. So this is not a quote just yesterday. In other words, she's been saying this for a long time. They, the viewers, digest it on a lot of different levels. Some talking about homosexuality and sexual promiscuity. Some people will see it and be disgusted by it. Maybe they'll be unconsciously aroused by it. If people keep seeing it and seeing it and seeing it, eventually it's not going to be such a strange thing. It's true. This particular song is called Hollywood, Hollywood. How could it hurt you when it looks so good? Music stations always play the same song. We're bored with the concept of right and wrong. This was at the end, this was the song at the end of that music awards with the three of them singing it. And everyone went ballistic as they paid homage to their idols. At the end, that robotic voice said, change the station, change the channel. Yeah, I would agree. Amen? Britney Spears. Britney Spears quickly transitioned from a popular sweet teen star into an even more popular Madonna imitator. At the transition of her career, the American Family Association called for a ban on her music, noting it was a disturbing mix of childhood innocence and adult sexuality. And she started to change. You'll notice we have little black boxes because we're just blacking out stuff that I don't want you gentlemen to be beholding and stumble right here in the middle of the seminar. Adult sexuality. Yeah, that's a new picture of her. And she began to be groomed into the sexual crazy girl. Here's what happens. They train up these little girls, these young girls, on Disney. And Britney Spears started on Disney, in the Disney Channel. And so they train them up and they sing about boys and girls. And they sing about, you know, oh, my heartache for this. They sing about just things, okay? That's not necessarily, it's not great, but that's what they do. And so they get this huge following of millions of young little girls that want to be like them and act like them. And then as they transition, because they're just a little bit too old now for Disney, and they transition into their own solo careers as singers and as artists, they bring along with them all these millions of young girls, and now they go through a transitional period where they start to transition into these crazy sexual creatures, and all these little girls want to be like them because they idolize them. And mom and dad has let them listen to them for years now. So why couldn't they listen to them with the breakout album? Britney upped the ante. Her music and image became increasingly more provocative. There's another new provocative image we had to block out. And there's this whole thing now where these girls will stand there and they're actually just like pushing down their pants. And it makes these men just go nuts. And these little girls want to get their pants down now around their hips and start showing belly buttons and skin and legs and everything else. Why? Well, that's what their idols are doing. As Britney upped the ante, she too took on an alter ego, Mona Lisa, to try to separate herself from her vile behavior. Britney Spears, Inside an American Tragedy, Rolling Stone did an article on her. Quote, she was a pop princess. Now she's in and out of hospitals, rehab, and court. How Britney lost it all. Sadly, her life, as we many people know, spun out of control. She was shaving her head, lashing out at fans, rehab, losing her kids. And she's only recently begun to seemingly pick up the pieces, but her music and her image has become even more provocative, and she is reclusive. She's very distant from her friends and from family. And so her life, she focuses in on her career. She's becoming more overtly sexual. And that's what's happening from the 2000s up to today. Everything's just becoming so licentious and so carnal and so sexual. Have you seen it? Have you heard it? Have you? Yeah, it's out there everywhere. Christina Aguilera. Well, again, another girl that started with Disney, singing all these little bubblegum, type songs. And eventually she transitioned and had her breakout album, and she took millions of viewers with her and listeners with her into her new lifestyle. When questioned about how sexually provocative she is, she claims, "Oh, it's not me, it's Xtina." She's not Christina, she's Xtina. And that's her alter ego of all her vile and nasty stuff that she does. So do what thou wilt. Feed the carnal dog. Doesn't matter. Forget the spiritual man. Just feed the carnal, the carnal, the carnal, the carnal. Now, she went from that to that. I'm not myself tonight. And I didn't draw the horns and the little devil tail on there. That's actually the album cover. So, here's two music clips. And this is what happens. They release this beautiful songs that all the girls and guys go, "Oh, I like that. I want to listen to that."
I turn to you for the strength to be strong, for the will to carry on.
Beautiful voice.
For everything you do.
And there's nothing wrong with the lyrics,
for
really.
Everything that's true, I turn to you.
The syncopated beat and rhythm, not the best for the Christian. I'm not going to listen to it. Because even slow syncopation has a problem on our physiology and our neurology. But yet, you can listen to the same girl and you have this song.
I'm out of character, I'm in rare form. And if you really know me, you know it's not the norm. Because I'm doing things that I normally don't do.
Right? So what happens is we have these breakout songs. I turn to you, and oh, I love that. And then the girls run out and they get the album because, oh, that's so beautiful. And they listen to the songs, and then they have all this other music on it, and some of it is 100% inappropriate, stirring up the carnal passions and the desires in these little girls. The Grammy-winning Christina Aguilera sings like an angel, but has the devil of an image, TV Guide reported in 2000. I'm a genie in a bottle. That's one of her songs. I'm a genie in a bottle. It boasts enough. Now, this is Rolling Stone reporting on this. It says, quote, "It boasts enough sexual innuendo to make Little Red Corvette by Prince sound like a nice song about changing your oil." Now, if you know the song Little Red Corvette, it's actually all symbolic imagery about inappropriate sexual relations. And they're saying that just pales in comparison to what this girl sings about. It'll make you blush.
My body's saying let's go,
but my heart is saying no. So then, and then it's talking about, you rub me the right way, basically you're going to have your way, and let's do whatever we want to. In other words, do what thou wilt, don't judge me, and let me do whatever I want to. Fort Lauderdale Sun Sentinel says, it looks like Xtina should change her name to Triple Xtina. That's hysterical to me. I mean, it's a terrible commentary of what's going on in our society. It's not Elvis going like this anymore. It's ridiculous what's allowed to happen and to be put on albums. And so many of the albums now, even these girls, they have language that's explicit on their labels, said, oh, explicit content. And they won't sell it in the stores to the minors. And mommy and daddy have to buy it for them. But guess what? Kids don't go to the stores to buy music anymore. You can just download it. Are you 18 years older? Uh-huh. Oh. And then they go out and they act out what they're hearing. A revealing review. Underneath all her talk about doing what she wants to do, Aguilera actually betrays a deep depression in her words and music. She was willing to ditch traditional morality for the promise of easy money. And just like Britney, there was a price for her decision. She shared, "I no longer want to be thought of as pretty," remarking, "I don't like pretty." So obviously the do what thou wilt recipe is not the recipe for happiness. She also got into self-mutilation, explaining that there's comfort to me in pain. She started cutting herself. So friends, if she's at the top of the world in her musical career, don't you think there'd be a little happiness and joy there? Well, that's the lie of the devil. If you go and if you do these things and you be this stuff and you listen to all of this, and so what we do is we live vicariously through these different people and their music, and they're talking about all this freedom when they themselves are cutting themselves, taking the drugs and drinking the alcohol because their life is empty. And we don't think that we are not going to be like that and be affected by it. Of course we will. If we listen to empty things, we become empty people. You want something of substance? Get in the Word of God. Listen to Christian music. Be ennobled and uplifted and edified to your Maker. Oh, that's just too goody-two-shoe. What? That music bores me. Well, then it's time for a fast. Get off of the devil's fat that's going to kill us anyway, and get onto the sincere milk of the Word in the music in the Christian industry that is acceptable. Man. I wish this place was packed with young people. You know where I love to give this presentation? I love giving it at academies. Love it. I'll go in for weeks of prayer and the whole school is changed. I'm serious. I have letters. In fact, I'll try to bring some tomorrow to share some with you. I have letters from young people and letters from the principals saying our whole academy is different. There's a whole sweep of spiritual connection in our institution. The kids are coming to us and saying, I'm sorry, but I've been sneaking this, and here I wanted to give it to you. And I had told the staff, any young person, I told them, I come up with what's called the white flag. What I call it? The white flag program or something like that. The white flag program to where, and I even said, students, walk up to the staff or the principal, flashing a white flag, and they'll remember, oh yeah, we're not going to put you on social, what it's called, or we're not going to kick you out of school because you have some contraband. So they flash the little flag and go, okay, I need to talk to you right now. And as a result, communication begins to happen with the teachers and with the young people, and it starts to change, and they work together, and Jesus Christ is poured out on that campus, and miracles happen. I'm serious. It's awesome. And it's not because I'm some great preacher or something. It's because God is great, and He loves every single one of us. And there is more in a life with Jesus. Undoubtedly, the most influential alter ego team of today is Beyonce and Sasha Fierce. And when I'm in a group of young people, this is where they all go, oh, because they're like listening to it. So this is actually the same CD. And on this same CD, the front, we have this beautiful picture, gorgeous woman. And then we turn it over and we have Sasha Fierce, her alter ego. Now, have you noticed what she's wearing? A goat. What is she doing wearing a goat? She was raised a Christian. She started singing in the church. And so many young people say, oh, well, I listen to Beyonce because Beyonce's a Christian. What's a Christian doing wearing a goat? The goat is the symbol of who? Satan. What's going on here? So I can be an angel on the cover, but I can be the devil on the back. She's loved by both secular and Christian circles. She grew up singing gospel, and so she has a very large Christian following. Beyonce said in Parade magazine 2006, "When I see a video of myself on stage or on TV, I'm like, who's that girl? That's not me. I wouldn't dare do that." She continues, "I created my stage persona to protect myself so that when I go home, I don't have to think about what it is that I do. Sasha is not me. I wouldn't like her. I wouldn't like Sasha if I met her off stage." So here she's saying, I'm doing what I want to do, but it's not really me. It's Sasha. It's the same philosophy, but now we're just tweaking it. right? All the way from Aleister Crowley. That's not me, that's Sasha. So tell me about Sasha. They have all these interviews. Tell me about Sasha. Well, let me call her up. Oh, okay, Sasha. Oh, no, I'm just kidding.
Mary. Okay, that's a top song,
and she is singing. It's actually lyrically, it's not a bad song. She's talking about how guys are jerks to women sometimes. If I were a boy, I'd be a better man. Is all she's saying. And so the lyrical content's not that bad. Now the music leaves a lot to be desired. It would be inappropriate for us as Christians to listen to. It's got that prefrontal cortex inhibiting factor, the polyrhythmic elements. Now this is very interesting to me. We have a remix of this song. And this remix is, well, if you want to play, do you think that song would be played in the clubs the way it was? It actually wouldn't. It might be played at a high school dance or maybe at a slow dance somewhere, but in a club, it really wouldn't be. So what they really need to do is accent the polyrhythmic elements and bring it even more to the forefront for it to be a remix for a club. Same song, listen to what they do, and the prefrontal cortex is bye-bye. Oh, what did they add? They added voodoo. Listen. Even the keyboard. Listen to that. Oh yeah, is that club music right there? Oh, everybody's going. Do you think they know what they're doing? Of course. Of course they know what they're doing. Prefrontal cortex. Gone. Are you with me? All right. You're scared, but you're with us. You should be scared, and that's the point, amen? Woo! The things I do when performing, I would never normally do, she says. I reveal things about myself that I wouldn't do in an interview. I have outer body experiences on stage. If I cut my leg, if I fall, I don't even feel it. I'm so fearless. I'm not aware of my face or my body. Friends, what do you think's going on there? It's possession. Undoubtedly, it's possession. Beyoncé finally boasted in 2010. 4 years later, she says, Sasha Fierce is done. I killed her. And I said, oh, praise the Lord. Amen. And then I realized, look at this, on the front of her cover, she's got a cross hanging from her wrist. I was like, oh, is she converted? Wouldn't that be awesome? And she actually turned her gorgeous voice over to the Lord. Oh, she's got an amazing voice, a gift from God. She started in the church, but she took that gift to use it for the devil. She says, Sasha Fierce is done. I killed her. She went on saying, she's comfortable enough with herself to be all of those things without an alias. She says, quote, I don't need Sasha Fierce anymore because I've grown and now I'm able to merge the two. What messages be given to our young people when these stars can behave in every uncouth, sexually explicit, arrogant, profane manner and cloak it under an alter ego and excuse it? What message is be giving? What message is being given? Somehow making themselves and everyone else think that we can have a wholesome side of ourselves and a hellish side and it's acceptable. The notion that we can be a devil and an angel is a lie, my friends. How much more confusing is it when some of these artists claim to be Christians? Whose gospel are they teaching? The Word of God says, if they speak not according to my word, it is because there is what? No light in them. There are false prophets that have gone out into the world, my friends. So now, let's not confuse ourselves that it is only an overtly sexual mold that the world is trying to push us into, that it's just one facet of immorality that's being portrayed. So it's not just the sex. There's so many facets of what's going on right now in the music. It's absolutely overwhelming. In this beautifully written book, Jerry Bridges, The Pursuit of Holiness, he writes this: the music we listen to often carries the message of the world, and the world uses the medium of music to squeeze us into its mold. And a Christian cannot help being gradually influenced if he continually listens to the world's music. Is he right? Absolutely. Eminem, probably one of the most despicable lyricists on the scene today, has been hailed by Billboard magazine as the best artist of the decade. And so here he is, a rap artist, a hip-hop artist, who is singing and rapping his way into the hearts of millions of people. Guess what? He's dominantly known for his works done under his alter ego, Slim Shady. Slim Shady is just the evil thoughts that come into my head, he said. I had this whole Slim Shady concept of being two different people, having two different sides of me. He says he is still Eminem, though. Slim Shady is just another part of him, the dark, evil, creatively sick part. Here it is again. Do what thou wilt. Feed the carnal dog. Forget the spiritual. Starve him. It's okay to embrace both sides of yourself. In 2009, he became the best-selling rapper of all time. He is said to be one of the most influential figures of the 21st century. Not the Nobel Peace Prize winners. A rapper. You got to be kidding me. A rapper is the most influential figure of the 21st century. On the best-selling albums chart from 2000 to 2009, one of his albums was third, another seventh, another 14th in the world. Not just here, in the world. 2010, his music generated 194 million streams more than any other artist. So what kind of role model is he? He says in an interview, he shared, I'd be lying if I said I didn't think kids looked at me as a role model. So what kind of role model is he? Well, in his song, Kill You, he speaks about murdering and raping various women, including his mother. In another song, he graphically raps about killing his girlfriend and having their small child help him get rid of her by pushing her body off of a pier. And his lyrics are so disgusting and so graphic, yet he's the best-selling rap artist ever in the history of the world. The albums these songs came off of won a Grammy for Best Rap Album. Altogether so far, he has won 204 awards. The Wall Street Journal reported that rap is the leader in terms of influencing pop culture today. So if you want to get into the heads of young people and be a leader and to change them, then get into rap. Now, Christians think we should get into rap and try to change them in a good way. It doesn't work, and we'll explain that tomorrow. Now you're saying, how is this possible? How is it possible that these rap artists are so popular? Because not a lot of people love rap. Some do, some don't. I used to really love rap. I used to pop and break dance and into hip hop and all that kind of stuff. And so I used to really, really like it. But not everyone does. So how is it that these artists are becoming so huge and so successful? Well, rap is not played everywhere like pop and soft rock is. So what happens is we now have crossovers happening. So we have a song by Eminem, a rapper, featuring Rihanna, who's a pop star. And their song together is entitled, I Love the Way You Lie. So here's Eminem, and then Rihanna.
Watch me burn.
What? It's okay, let me burn. I like the way it hurts. We're not even going to get into that. In 2010, Eminem was asked, does Slim Shady, your rapping and killing alter ego, still exist? Or have you split with him? Shady still exists, but I don't think the subjects on this record call for, you know, bringing the chainsaws and axes out and murder everyone. So he has a new... He had this new album come out, and he's saying, no, we're just not going to necessarily bring out the chainsaws and axes and murder everyone on this album. So that's his normal MO. What's even more sick to me than this is that through all of the MTVs and the VH1s and all the other music video networks, we can watch these songs now come to life. It's not just in our imagination. Now we have directors that are cinematic experts creating these images before our eyes, and they leave these indelible prints on our impressionable young children's minds. It's disgusting. Sin is getting exceedingly sinful. And friends, we're only talking about music. We're not even talking about what's going on in the movies, what's going on in the adult world. We're not talking about the entertainment-laden mind. We're not talking about the first-person shooter video games. We're not talking about the blood and the guts and the gore and the news and all the junk that's going on. We're just talking about music. Jesus Christ is coming soon. Huh. I don't know how it's going to last much longer, my friends. I'm serious. You know when they said that before the flood that their thoughts were only evil continually? I think we're almost there again. It's just music. That's all. It's just fun, Christian. It's just music. No. Take your head out of the sand. Take the scales off your eyes. Amen. Another rap artist that's getting more mainstream airplay is Jay-Z. One of the most financially successful hip-hop artists and entrepreneurs actually in America. And he's popular for the same thing like Eminem, having songs featuring other pop singers like Beyoncé, who, by the way, is his wife, Rihanna, and this one, Alicia Keys. You ever heard this song, Empire State of Mind?
And Jesus can't save you. Life starts when the church in. Came here for school, graduated to the highlight. Ball players, rap stars, addicted to the limelight. Empty in May, got you feeling like a champion. The city never sleeps, better slip you an ambient.
He's talking about that. What did you hear the lyrics at the beginning? What did it say? That life starts when the church ends. Jesus can't save you. They go through all of this lyrical content because the reality in their mind is, it's do what thou wilt, the church is a joke, and Jesus is not real. And this goes into our brains, this changes our psyche, but it's just music. We don't need to be surprised that unbelievers act like unbelievers, my friends. He doesn't claim to be a Christian, and unlike his wife, whom we've already talked about, Beyoncé, the dangers of her mixed messages, but he is doing his own thing. So we shouldn't be alarmed when he's saying Jesus can't save you and all this kind of stuff, because he's never professed to be a Christian. Romans 8:7-8 says, because the carnal mind is enmity against God, for it is not subject to the law of God. So then that they are in the flesh cannot please God. And of course, when there is no spiritual compass in our life, that they don't even think of pleasing God. It's all about themselves. We have to guard what's coming in. And by the way, it said that MDA got you feeling like a champion. MDA is another word for ecstasy. It's talking about drugs, talking about all this stuff. And on top of being a rapper, Jay-Z is a record producer. He owns nightclubs and an NBA team. He's the creator of his own clothing line, Rockaware, of which the shirt that he is wearing here, you just might want to notice what it says on his own clothing line. Do what thou wilt. He believes in the Crowleyan philosophy. Little heavy, isn't it? It just keeps going and going and going. My brands are an extension of me. Well, here's a Masonic symbol on some of his clothing. The all-seeing triangle, the pyramid structures. And he's pointing to different demonic images. Here's an eye, the all-seeing eye. He's got a hat with the eye of Horus. And all of these are occultic. And you'll notice here, this shirt that he sells, it says Masters of the Craft. It's no longer even like secret. He's making money on selling shirts that have occult symbols on it. And like Anton LaVey said, no, the Church of Satan and the Satanic Bible is more accepted now today because people are willing and ready to accept what it says. Why? Because all of the groundwork has been done by his evangelists. And you'll notice this everywhere. Show me what you got. This is his album cover. And you have this triangle and this light beaming through it. And he makes triangles. This is his symbol now. He makes triangles. And then here's another image where he puts his eye through the triangle and the photograph is at just the right position. You'll see that sign more and more. Here he is here giving the sign at his concert. Here he is with multiple other singers, Rihanna, Kanye West, and they're all standing there with their symbols going like this. What does that have? What are they doing there? Did they just happen to be going, oh, that's a cool sign? Come on, friends. And here we are, got more of them. And then here's his congregants at his concert, all returning the satanic symbol. But it's just music. Don't worry about it. Many other places, many other bands like Iron Maiden, Earth, Wind, and Fire. These are different album covers that have all of this symbolism on it. Earth, Wind, and Fire. Look at the pyramid again. And then look at all these people. You've got Christina Aguilera, MC Light, A-Rod, Rihanna. Why are they all doing these satanic symbols? Friends, they're sending messages to those who are in the know. That's what's going on. More satanic symbols. Rihanna, this is her album, Dark Angel. Here's Rihanna again, and she has on her fingers are different rings of Baphomet and skulls and the goat on her rings. And I don't know why she's dressed like that, but that's pretty interesting to me. Gene Simmons, Kiss, The Beatles, Snoop Dogg, Pink, Neo, Madonna, Beyonce, and they're doing this, that's a sign of the devil, the goat. They're doing this, that's 666. They all are flashing the signs, and it's on purpose. And then we have other satanic symbols. We have Bono. There they are again. It's a creative pose, you would think. But why is it that all these artists are covering that eye? Why are they having that only that all-seeing eye come out again? Why? It's not by chance, friends. It's over and over and over. You'd think they'd be a little original, right? It's not because they're falling in line with everybody. It's just part of the philosophy that they believe and they live. And they want us to be like them. Eminem, Busta Rhymes, Lady Gaga. Satanic symbols everywhere. Here we have Christina Aguilera, Justin Timberlake, Paramore. Look at this. What is this? What is he going, hey, everything's A-okay? No, he's going, it's very posed. It's 666, and he has his eye going through it. They're sending messages. It's not all of a sudden everybody decided, hey, let's do this and let's do that and let's like cover our eyeballs. No. That's what we want to think, because we don't want to think, oh, these great singers. Oh, I don't know why people fall down in adoration to people that can sing. I don't get it. People even do it when I sing. They go, oh, I'm like, I'm just a person that's singing. Don't do that. Amen? I don't know what it is. It's just singing. Big deal. But we set people up on platforms and we worship them. We want to be like them. We want to talk like them. We want to dress like them. We want to pose like them. Oh, boy. This is just heavy stuff. And because I'm only sharing a fraction of what we've uncovered, I'm probably going to have to write a very thick book. Snoop Dogg, and it just keeps going and going. Jim Jones, Lil Wayne, Beyonce. Beyonce's wearing a, right here, you can see it, it's blown up. She's wearing a Baphomet ring now. I was like, what's the deal? Because she's hanging out with her unconverted demonic husband, and she's been converted herself. That's why. Her music has converted her. And a lady dripping with occult imagery is none other than Lady Gaga. Something is up with this woman. And there is a tremendous desire from secular and Christians even, because she's so intriguing and they listen to her. Madonna told Rolling Stone that she sees herself in Lady Gaga. In response to the comparison between herself and Madonna, Gaga stated, quote, I don't want to sound presumptuous, but I've made it my goal to revolutionize pop music. The last revolution was launched by Madonna 25 years ago. Both Time magazine and Forbes included Gaga in its annual Time 100 list of the most influential people in the world. I have the article, and it shows, you know, all these different people, Barack Obama, and all these different people that have influenced the world, and she's one of the people that's in there as one of the most influential people in the world. Forbes also placed her at number 7 on their annual list of the world's 100 most powerful women. Lady Gaga, she says, my art is liberation. I want to free you. What's that sound like? Do what thou wilt in full bloom. February 5th, 2008, music is well known, this is in the New York Times, music is well known to connect deeply with adolescents and to influence identity development, perhaps more than any other entertainment medium. The impact of music lyrics. The lyrics of today's popular music are increasingly explicit. A study of 14 to 16-year-olds showed that they listened to music on average of 40 hours per week. Now, let me ask you this question. Do you think our Christian kids are listening to it any less? No. Do you think they're spending at least the same amount of time in the Word of God? No. That'd be 80 hours in the week. So if we're not spending enough time in the Word of God, and that doesn't even balance with what we're doing with our secular employment, our secular engagement, then what happens is we start to have a deficit. Because even if it's equal, you could flip a coin. Am I a spiritual dog or am I the carnal dog? I don't know. I'm feeding both. But friends, if we're sitting here feeding our minds for 40 hours a week, and that's talking about music, not talking about all the internet junk and the TV and the movies. I don't even know how you could fit that into your life. But friends, a massive conversion is underway right now. The music that they're listening to plays a large part in their lives, especially influencing self-identity. Any bad influences in the music would have a very direct effect on the adolescent. Here is something key for us to understand. A child's frontal moral lobe is not fully developed. And we as parents, spiritually speaking, we are supposed to be there, to be their moral compass, if you will. But instead of being active parents in our children's lives, we let the TV, we let the music, or the video games babysit our children. Therefore, at the young, impressionable ages, when their character is being formed, it's being formed into the image of the devil. I think they're called a generation of vipers. So let's look at a few more influences, and we'll move along. We're almost done. So let's look at a few more. There are some young people that are being molded by this young lady. Oh, some little ones went, oh no! Hannah Montana. Or more accurately, Miley Cyrus. For those of you who do not know, this is a Disney show, and it follows the life of this girl pictured right here, Miley Cyrus, who is Hannah Montana. So this side of the pic, she is Miley Cyrus. This side, she's Hannah Montana, who occupies, by the way, Miley is her daytime persona, and Hannah Montana is her alter ego. Alter ego. Now we got a little kid doing alter egos. And this is her rock star nighttime life. The theme of the show is called The Best of Both Worlds. Oh, you can have the best of both worlds, and it doesn't matter. You're still going to go to heaven. Don't worry about it. Because she gets to be just a normal girl, but when she wants to, she can become a famous rock star. Obviously, it's not based on reality. So what about Miley's real life? Well, here again, we start out with this young lady that sings very well, and she takes this whole young fan base. And by the way, little girls want to dress like her because she has clothing, and she's got makeup, and she's got shoes, and she's got purses, and she's got everything Miley Cyrus. No, excuse me, Hannah Montana. So millions of followers. And so she's another young singer who started out more innocent and sweet, but she too is changing. Here's her latest CD entitled Can't Be Tamed. Just like Christina and Britney, it's the same kind of pathway, leading them right into perdition. So here's a song entitled Who Owns My Heart. Now, she has a new song that we sound, and this is a song that we found very interesting. So let's listen to the clip, and we'll talk about it in just a moment. So what I want you to do is I want you to imagine what kind of place that she's in when this music is being played, okay? Did you catch that? Who owns my heart? Is it love or is it art? I don't know if I'm being influenced by the music or is this really love? Now, there's a music video of this. Where do you suppose she is with this song and she's dancing, doing whatever? Where do you think she is? In a club. Okay, you're right. She's in a club type setting. So who do you think she's dancing with? Who do you think's all around her? A bunch of boys and guys. Guess what? You're wrong. She's almost exclusively dancing with girls. Who owns my heart? Is it love or is it art? I'm dancing on the floor with you, and when you touch my hand, I go crazy. The music tells me what to feel. I like you now, but is that real? By the time we say goodnight, I don't know if this is right. So she's contemplating having a homosexual encounter. It's just music. No, it's not. And I feel you coming through my veins. Am I into you or is the music to blame? Uh-oh, she's tattling. Who owns my heart? Is it love or is it art? Because the way you got your body moving got me confusing. I can't tell if it's the beat or the sparks. So they're pushing the sensuality and the sexual content over and over and over again. And then we come to someone like this, Justin Bieber. Oh, no! I know. This is where I'm stepping on the toes. He's got this song called Baby. Okay, he's a young boy talking about love and baby, baby, and all the little girls are going, oh, I want to be with you. It's if you go on the internet and look up Bieber fans, it's unbelievable. They sit there and they're thinking, it's just so sad. It's so sad what these people are doing. They're preying on the hearts of our children. And they're just ripping them apart and wrenching them. And they're so sad because they never even got to be seen when he was at his concert. I thought I could at least touch him. What is that? Idol worship? Yeah, it is. What's a little kid know about love anyway? He doesn't. Most grown men don't even know a lot about love. Now, here's some fans right here. And he's just running along, thousands of people going like this. And the kids are going, I touched him! I'll never wash my finger again. Okay, where's that tape? I gotta cover it. I need to. Sorry. But that's what's going on. It's almost ridiculous. The guy, he doesn't even have a never mind, okay. So here are the titles of a few of his songs. Baby. Another one, Never Let You Go. One Less Lonely Girl. Favorite Girl. Love Me. Can't Live Without You. Pick Me. Somebody Love. Next to You. Runaway Love. It's all about this. And all these little girls are just sitting there going, oh, Bieber. They wear shirts. They even, little girls are wearing pants that have his name right here. No, I'm serious. What is this? It's all propaganda. It's this big machine, and we're just little tiny cogs paying for it all. It's pathetic and it's disgusting to me because it's of the devil. And here we are telling our young people, telling our Christian young people that we shouldn't be dating. I mean, I'm teaching my children, you are not ready to date, because if you're not ready to take care of a wife, why would you even date? I mean, do you understand that concept? Because what is dating all about? It's supposed to be about finding your life partner, right? Well, that's not what dating is actually about. Dating is about kissy, kissy, touchy, touchy. Courting a woman is about finding a life mate. And so you look and you find that person and you enter into a beautiful, godly courtship. And so we teach our young people, save yourself for marriage. And so imagine this, a young lady who's listening to the Bieber music about I love you, and all this stuff, and I want you to pick me, and all this kinds of lovely, lovey, lovey, lovey-dovey, releasing gonadotropin sex hormones, and now we tell them, save yourself, but go ahead and listen to Justin Bieber. What? It's like we are loading the gun against our own children. But I don't want to make them mad. Too bad, make them mad if you want them to be in heaven. Amen? If my children want to listen to this, it's an absolute, no, unequivocal no. No, because I know what it does to the mind. I know what it does to the physiology. I know what it does to the spiritual longings of the heart. It dulls them. It's a no. If my children don't understand, that's okay. My children do. They've sat through the seminar about 6 times. I should have my son Tyler come up here and preach it. Amen? In fact, we're even thinking about having Tyler put on a little seminar for the young ones about music. I think it'd be pretty powerful. Another one of his albums, Kiss and Tell. Oh. You know, if we process these things through a little bit, it's not difficult to figure out why the struggle to stay pure is so hard. We've got boys this age singing into the ears of our little girls, and we're making it harder for them to control their budding passions. Here's some of the lyrics. Now I can see it, girl. You ain't gonna say nothing. Your lips are calling me like they want to do something. I'm sorry, he's a little teenager. I feel the chemistry. Yeah, you're into me. A little kiss is a definite possibility. Seen you a couple of times. Had a couple conversations since you've been on my mind. Had a couple observations. Like, you're a fly chick. You could be my chick. Play by the rules and you can get what I give. Just keep it quiet. Keep it on the hush. And what we do, it's just between us. Baby, I know that you're cool with rocking with me, but I can't have you telling everybody that you got me all twisted with your lips like this, so don't tell your homies, don't tell your mama, don't tell your girlfriends. I'll treat you real good. You keep this private, and you can get what I give. And the little girls are listening to this stuff. Unbelievable. And the boys are listening to this stuff. I don't even know why a boy would want to hear that sung in their ears. Have you ever thought about that? You got boys singing that kind of stuff in boys' ears? No, thank you. It's no wonder he's on the cover of dozens of magazines talking about the Bieber fever with bylines like Justin on Girls, 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 Kiss and Tell, his dating diary. And friends, he's just a teenage boy. Ah, mercy. And here's another. Taylor Swift.
Oh, no, not Taylor Swift.
A sweet girl compared to some of the girls we've talked about earlier. It almost seems silly to bring her up. But this is one of those gray areas, because some of these, you know, like Triple X Tina, we go, oh yeah, we shouldn't be listening to that. Okay, I get that, right? Britney and Miley Cyrus, and we go, okay, well, I get that. But then like Taylor Swift, she's a sweet girl, she's a good girl, she still lives with her mommy and daddy, she does. Multimillionaire living with mom and dad. But this type of soft rock or country music, or your Bruno Mars or Keith Urban or Lady Antebellum, Rascal Flatts, or Josh Groban, they all kind of fall in this category. And it's actually very popular amongst Christians, especially with our teenage girls. And this would be the type of music that my wife was talking about in our first meeting that she would listen to when she wanted to drag out her pain over some heartache or some boy that didn't look at her the right way. Living out her emotions through the songs, remember when she talked about that? So this is the music that we tend to connect with, or identify with more on an emotional level. So here's what she says, though. Look at the lyrics. So I'm sorry, what is she singing about? Sneaking out of the house into the garden. Keep quiet, because we're dead if they knew our parents. So close your eyes, escape to this town for a little while. Do what thou wilt. Even in a lot of the gray area music, my friends. This one is so much tamer compared to some of the others that we listen to. And so it's like the devil gets a pass. He gets under the radar. Because it's just talking about this stuff. It's talking about sneaking out and doing what we should not be doing, having premarital sex. She's a young girl singing about these things. And she's not married. Most of her songs deal with young love, wanted love, or broken hearts. Teardrops on my guitar, last kiss, haunted, picture to burn, to name a few of her jilted songs. Blender magazine cover says, meet the boyfriend bashing radio, ruling girl next door. Uh-oh. She starts to get a little bit more of an attitude. Glamour magazine says the truth about all those guys she sings about. So let's look at the lyrics of a few of her other songs. Well, you stood there with me in the doorway. My hands shake. I'm not usually this way. But you pull me in and I'm a little more brave. It's the first kiss. It's flawless. Really something. It's fearless. Our song is the slamming front door, sneaking out late, tapping on your window. When we're on the phone and it's late and you talk real slow because it's late and your mama don't know. Get me with those green eyes, baby. As the lights go down, give me something. What? Give me something that will haunt me when you're not around. I will run my fingers through your hair and watch the lights go wild. Just keep on keeping your eyes on me. It's just wrong enough to make me feel right. And lead me up to the staircase. Won't you whisper soft and slow? I'm captivated by you, baby, like a fireworks show. So these are the songs that are acceptable now, and they're talking about their first inappropriate encounter. It's a song entitled Sparks Fly. We have to use our Christian filter, friends, in helping us to decide what themes are best to let our minds dwell upon. Would you agree? We need to be careful that we don't accept just everything that an artist has simply because they may have a few good songs. For instance, Carrie Underwood. She is a secular singer, but she is a Christian. And some of her music has Christian themes, such as Jesus, Take the Wheel.
I've been living my life. I know I've got to change. So from now on tonight, Jesus, take the wheel. Take it from my hand.
So lyrically, it's a great song. There's actually nothing wrong with that song lyrically. We should let Jesus have the wheel of our lives. Amen? But unfortunately, the rhythm section poses some issues for us. We have the polyrhythmic elements going on, which affect the frontal lobe and the physiology and release all the gonadotropins and all the things that we've learned. It's a good message lyrically, but not musically. But then on the same CD, she has a song called Before He Cheats. It's all about music. It's all about revenge and getting even. You hurt me, so I'm going to hurt you. Is that a biblical principle? No. There is motive in that song right there. Uh-oh. All of a sudden, she's becoming a vengeful bad girl. And she's not even dressed kind of nice. She's like, I'm going to look at that car. Ouch is right. That's not allowing the prefrontal cortex to do its job when I want to get revenge and God says, no, revenge is mine. No, it's I'm going to do what I want to do no matter what God says. Even if the principle is wrong, I'm still going to do it because he hurt me. The theme of do what thou wilt is woven everywhere. It's feeding the carnal dog. It doesn't line up with the new man that God is trying to create within us. Back to the book, Pursuit of Holiness. We're almost done. Our responsibility regarding our wills is to guard our minds and emotions, being aware of what influences our minds and stimulates our desires. As we do our part, we will see the Spirit of God do His part, making us more holy. So today, do what thou wilt is in full bloom. Pervasive media has severely desensitized everyone to sin. Now we are claiming to be a nation to be more Christian than ever in this nation. Christianity, though, barely resembles anything close to the biblical exhortations shared in God's holy word. But you may say, but Christian, I don't listen to secular music. I only listen to Christian music. Well, the challenge is that in a majority of all the, quote, Christian music produced today, there are many problems that make it difficult for the informed Christian to listen to it. So shall we take a quick listen? This is where I step on more toes. It's okay? Praise the Lord. Remember, Christian music is about the message. And if in any way the music gets in the way of the message, that creates a problem for us. If it's too fast, remember in the melodies, in the rhythm section we talked about? If it's too slow, if it's too complex, if it's the wrong key, the wrong rhythm, etc. The point is that music is to help or to support the lyrical message, and it should lift us as Christians to the throne of God. Let's take a listen. You could do it all a cappella if you want. Boom, ba-boom, ba-boom, ba-boom. The clapping and stomping. Boom, ba. So what I want you to do is listen. Listen. I want you to know, are you thinking about Christ or are you being drawn to the music? This is all Christian. All the same polyrhythmic voodoo elements. Without your all consuming passion inside of me. How do I spend my whole life asking? What if I had given it? But I like how it makes me feel. Yeah, I'm worshiping God now, right?
I'm a whole new guy with a whole new fire. Change inside, more flame in the fire.
Amen. Oh, eh, oh, it's over. So what do you think about that? Are there problems there? There are. In our next two sessions, we are going to jump deeply into the contemporary Christian music movement. And I believe light bulbs will go on for you. The Word of God declares in Romans 12:2, "Be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may be able to prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God." Friends, it's time to consecrate our lives to God and stop playing around with the devil's music. It's true. Because God is looking for a people who will stand though the heavens may fall. He's looking for a people that will say, "No, Father, not my will, not the devil's will, not Anton LaVey's will, not Crowley's will, but your will be done." Don't let the devil serenade you into the pit that we never return from. But let God serenade you right into the pearly gates, amen? The devil's playing for keeps, but so is God. And it's time to stand on his side, amen? Now, I don't know if there are some of you here that have made some decisions regarding music that have been not the best. I'm sure most of us have not made the best decisions. But the reality is, if we come to God and say, "Lord, this is me. I made some poor choices. Please forgive me and give me the strength and power to walk in newness of life from this moment on," there will be no condemnation to our souls. Amen? Would you like to join me in a prayer of consecration, of rededication to God? If you would, I'd like to invite you to stand to your feet. Praise the Lord. You know what's happening right now? I think the angels are singing. Amen? What a glorious thought. In fact, we're told that God himself sings over every repentant soul. So let's give God some reason to sing tonight. What do you say? So in your heart, join with me in this prayer. And if you don't want to, that's okay. No problem. Because maybe you're just not ready. But hopefully the seeds that have been planted will take root, eventually change your life. Let's pray. Father in heaven, Lord, we have gone over a lot of ground. We've gone on an audible journey where we started with music was so beautiful and elevating, and we've come all the way through all of this just nastiness and the sexuality and the overt Satanism and all this stuff that we've seen. Lord, I pray that, yes, it would make an impact in our heart, but Lord, I ask that it would not trouble our souls because of what we heard tonight, in the sense that of these different clips. Maybe some of these clips brought us back to bad memories, and Lord, I ask that you would break those bonds and those tentacles even now. And Lord, I pray that if we are struggling in our hearts, and many of us are, to relinquish some of these things to you, I pray that you would just simply make us willing to be made willing to obey you. Father, we give this over to you, and we say, here am I, Father. Send me into the world to be a light. Forgive me for my sins. Cleanse me from my unrighteousness. And help me to walk in newness of life, Father. And give me the courage to uproot what we need to. Please, Lord, may this be the day that this Adventist church right here in Albuquerque, New Mexico, is set ablaze with the Holy Spirit, because we're willing to listen to your beautiful voice and not the voice of the devil anymore. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you.